What is it to take care of yourself? What are we taking care of? A million bedrooms.
Welcome to the 3% Podcast. This is Chad Post from Open Letter Books. I'm here with Tamara Barish from Riff Raff.
Hello, and I'm actually sitting in Riff Raff, closed today, but I'm here anyway. So,
just doing some back-end work?
Little fix-it projects, you know, nothing too serious, just little things that, improvements.
Yeah. Cool. It must be nice to hang out there on day off, in a way.
In a way, it's nice to be here when I don't have to worry about, dealing with customers or anything. And
you mean your loving customers that help keep you in business?
Exactly. Yes. No, but I mean, you know, you don't have to worry about someone coming in the door or something. I could be in the back room for an hour and it won't matter, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Very cool. So we're keeping on schedule for every two week podcast. So we're just going to basically just banter about a few different things today, right?
Yeah, the first was we get an email to the 3percentpodcast@gmail.com email from Aaron Cohen that says, "Hey guys, new listener to both 3% and 2MR, using the slang here. says, I don't feel like I have the expertise as solely an English speaker to judge the quality of translations. I was wondering if you all had any heuristics for judging the quality of a translation. Obviously, in many cases, there is only one option, but especially when there are, in some cases, 10 translations of the same work, how do you go about narrowing down which to select for a first reading of the text?"
Yeah, which is, an interesting question. There's two different sort of approaches that he seems to be getting at. I guess, or two different approaches depending on what type of book you're talking about. So if you're talking about like Don Quixote, there's a bunch of different options available to you. Right. And why would you choose one over the other? For what reasons? And then there's the second thing of, if you're reading a book that's only been translated once, how would you, do you have any sort of processes for judging whether that translation is good, I suppose, too, which is a bit different. And I guess with the first one, like that's a more interesting, because you can actually compare them and find a version that best suits you, which is maybe a bad answer in a way. Like rather than saying one is the best, there's certain times where like multiple versions of the book are equally good but have a different response for the reader. So like for instance, we're doing for the 2-month review the Pessoa's Book of Disquiet, the complete version from New Directions, which is, have you read that?
No.
Okay, so like the first half of it's not great. Like it's all like the stuff that never made it into the various versions before. It's like early work of his that sort of like leads into the Book of Disquiet and is like part of it, but he never put it together. And there's Margaret Jewel Costa translated that version and the version from Serpent's Tale, and Richard Zenith translated one from Penguin some years ago as well. And that's the one that I'd read in full, was the Penguin one. And there are differences in the, like their translations, and they both seem equally valid, but they emphasize a different tonality within the Pessoa character's voice. And I read there's a review that I had sitting on my desk, and I think I threw it away last week. But there was a review from someone when the New Directions one came out that compared a couple different passages between the Zenith and the Margaret Jewel Costa one, and was like, in the end, I liked the Zenith one better, but they're equally valid and they're equally good. And if you prefer this sort of tone, this sort of like voice, you're gonna like Margaret Jewel Costa's better. If you like this sort of voice, it's a little bit more playful and self-aware, you might like the Zenith one better. And you can go about it that way, where it's not really necessarily saying either one of these is bad, but they're both valid. But then there are times, like I do it for my class, we do their first in the spring class for World Literature and Translation, which I do actually want to talk about that later too, but the first assignment they have is three different versions of Master and Margarita, and it's the first chapter of each of the three, and all the markers are erased from these pages, and they have to choose which one they prefer. If they were like, I give them the situation, like if they were publishing it, which one would they publish and why would they publish that one versus the other two? Like, what do they find wrong with them or better about this one? And all of them have like, you can make a valid case for all three of them without a problem, but there are a couple that like stand out, and for various reasons, they capture more of the style and more of the tone. It's a tricky exercise for some people, especially if they don't know what Master and Margarita is. So I just have to explain that to them and hope that they get a sense of like how the book functions, because that opening scene where like they meet the devil has like elements of surrealism and like sort of funny and like all those kind of bits that make Master and Margarita really cool. But if you've never read it, they're just like, I don't know what the fuck this is. Like, you know, it's a book. But they do compare those three and come up with the one that they like. And over time, there's been one particular that gets more traction. There's two, actually. There's the Bergen one and, oh God, what's her name? The woman who translated it for Grove. Those two people they tend to dislike the Pavir and Volokansky one almost all the time. But other than that, like the two that they choose are the two that I prefer too. I don't like the Pavir and Volokansky one at all. It's very stiff and it's littered with footnotes. It's got like 4,000 footnotes.
Right.
But that's just defining the situation. He's asking about like heuristics or what you're looking for. And we go through this like bit by bit and line by line and look for moments where there's like a moment of translation ease that takes you out of the text is one that I say tend to try to avoid or want to avoid that. The fewer times that happens, the better. And that's just where the language all of a sudden is the tone doesn't match anymore. It's inconsistent. It's using phrasings that are awkward and not intentionally awkward or for any like good reason, but because they're just not working right. And then the more holistically large and undefinable thing for me is whether or not the book captures a unique style and voice that would be that's a reason why you would read that book in the first place. So if there's a book written in English, I start reading it and it's like clunky and slow and doesn't have anything special about it, I usually don't go on with it. But a book written in English or in translation that has something about the voice that's unique and that makes that seem like an interesting literary work or literary text, that's what I usually gravitate towards and I'm looking for. So in evaluating translations, I'm looking for that ability. And there's something about it that's like undefinable, like you can't always nail it down, but there's a confidence in the translator's text that gives you a sense of the voice. For instance, on a new book, I've been reading Emma's translation of Revenge of the Translator. And that's a very confident translation in which you know you get the sense of the voice and how that's constructed right away from the first page. And there's other things I read more recently that I'm not even going to name because I don't want to like dismiss any translator. But you read it and you're like, this is a little bit off. Like there's not the right, it feels uncertain. It feels like, oh, like for instance, like when one of our students was translating a German piece for a contest and everything about it feels uncertain and you're questioning like, I don't know what the sentence means. I don't feel like the translator knows what the sentence means. And they definitely don't know how the author is wanting to convey that sentence and what kind of overtones and what sort of shadings. They don't have that. And when you find that, then you know that then I feel like the translation is very solid and good. And even when you're comparing ones, I'm looking for that feeling right away.
I mean, I agree. Like, if you have the option and like compare something, which again, we're dealing mainly with the classics at this point,
because yeah.
That's the only sort of thing that would be published by multiple publishers and still available and all that sort of thing. I'm with you. It's to me, does it feel like it's, and this is such a vague sort of subjective thing, but does it feel like it captured the original? And oftentimes that comes down to what the themes are, the time and place that it was written, and the sort of literary, you know, style of the time, not necessarily that they adhere to it, like what the original author was doing, but being aware of where the original author fit into that sort of mindset, right? Like there are definitely many versions of Camus, right? And because it's been redone since, you know, God, from the 40s, 50s, a few times by various English translators here and in the UK. And so you can get a sense of which ones were trying to do what with the French that was like a style at the time, but also Camus was doing something that was different from a lot of French writers at the time and sort of introduced a new mode of writing in the same way that like Hemingway introduced a new sort of style of writing.
Yeah.
You know, just, you know, 20 years earlier. So you, that's, it's a very specific thing that you have the opportunity to sort of assess those things. And it's also very subjective. Like, yeah, I might like one translation better just because I think it's funnier or more playful. Someone else might like something better because they can envision it in the original French, if they know enough French to sort of be able to call that as they're reading it. I don't know. It's all very complicated. I do know that like a bad one is exactly what you're talking about, which is where they've clearly misunderstood the meaning of a particular sentence or construction in the original, and then when they translate it as faithfully as they think they can, it still doesn't make sense in English. And yeah, that's because they never truly understood the original. Like, that's a problem. And that is a sign that, you know, the sooner you see that in a text, like, the sooner you should walk away. Because it's not going to – that's not a problem that happens once in a book. It's bound to happen many, many times.
I'm trying to see if I can find this thing for you that I read. But there's a – God, where is it? I know I have it in here somewhere. There's – I have a the first few pages of – is it that awful mess on Via Murillani, whatever the Italian book that is very famous. I'm losing all of my words right now. The awful mess. I'm going to find it. Mess on Via Murillana, by, what's his name? Carlo Emilio Gatta, that was reprinted recently by New York Review of Books. And it was translated by William Weaver, who's incredibly famous, right? And he's like a well-respected translator of Italian literature. And he at some point had said that if there's one book that he would want to have retranslated of his, it would be this. And here's the opening paragraph. Everybody called him Don Ciccio by now. He was Officer Francesco Ingravallo, assigned to homicide, one of the youngest and, God knows why, most envied officials of the detective section, ubiquitous as the occasion required, omnipresent in all tenebrous matters, of medium height, rather rotund as to physique, or perhaps a bit squat, with black hair thick and curly, which sprang forth from his forehead at the halfway point, as if to shelter his two metaphysical knobs from the fine Italian sun. He had a somnolent look, a heavy lumbering walk, a slightly dull manner, like a person fighting a laborious digestion. Dressed as well as his slender government salary allowed him to dress, with one or two little stains of olive oil on his lapel, almost imperceptibly, however, like a souvenir of the hills of his malaise. And it goes on like that. They've cleaned this up a bit, but they're but it's a really awkward sounding translation. It's one of these books that was written in dialects, and as it used multiple Italian dialects, and so he tried to deal with that and never quite, I think, got it right. But it's a book that people have wanted to retranslate for a while, but this one's still in print. But it is one that, like, if you start reading it, like, I know a lot of people have tried to read this and just been like, no, like, I don't like this. I don't get it. I can't follow it. And it is one that I think is a bit clunky and awkward. And you know it right away. Like, as you start going through, it's like, I don't think I get what's going on here. And these word choices are very odd.
Yeah, those are odd word choices. Emma always talks about hitting the right register.
Yep.
Right? Which is different from it feels like the translator in what you just read sort of confused registers with dialects and sort of assigned a hierarchy of dialects. And then instead of trying to cope with the dialects, just assign them different registers, which is, one, very insulting. But two, you end up with these awkward word choices that you're using based on the perceived vocabulary of a particular dialect.
Yeah, right? And it's like ubiquitous, tenebrous. The one that still stands out to me that I've never quite figured out was his hair, which sprang forth from his forehead at the halfway point as if to shelter his two metaphysical knobs. I don't know what the metaphysical knobs are.
No idea.
Like, I've never been able to quite figure that out. At one point in time, I posited that it was like he had, like, isn't with your cuckolded, you have like horns?
It's, yeah, like, double. Yeah, exactly.
And that was maybe what it was about, but I couldn't figure, I've never really had a good solution to that. But yeah, the register on this is kind of all over the place. And that's one of the things we tell our students too, when they first start doing their translations and they go to our Plube workshop, is like, they tend to have register problems first and foremost. And then it's like a confidence problem. And sometimes it's as easy as being like, what is this saying? Like, what is this sentence supposed to be? And when they explain it in like normal words, they're like, oh, that's how you have to get that, convey that. What you're doing right now is like sticking to like some sort of idea of what the original is, but not really conveying what the author's trying to say with that sentence, and it's ending up being just confusing. And you don't want a reader to be like, I just don't understand what these words mean. Because that's just going to turn you off immediately. And if people have any sort of prejudice about like translation is going to be difficult or confusing or not like written in English in the way that I understand it, and you have some of those, then they're just going to tune out. And it's really unfortunate.
Right. Yeah, there's also, I mean, for me, and again, I can only speak to French here, but the French use a lot of, it's a little more rigid in terms of its structure, in terms of the way you construct a sentence, especially if it's something, like you're describing something or you're making an argument of some kind. In what I'm trying to get to here, they use the word that, okay, a mm-hmm. lot. Because it's just the structure of the language requires you to do so.
Yeah.
In English, if you write a sentence that had a lot of that, it would just seem excessive, right? And so you need to trim back, right? But then you'll get this argument like, oh, but that's not, you know, you're not being faithful to the original. And it's like, no, but that's not how you would say that in English, period.
Yeah.
And that's a sort of compromise that I think comes with confidence. Like you're talking about where the translator needs to say, okay, I now totally understand what I'm reading here. Here's how I would say it in the author's voice, but in English. And that does mean trimming back some things that we just don't use in English the same way.
Yeah.
And it comes with experience. It comes with confidence. It also comes with just, I mean, Emma does this a lot and she probably, who knows, maybe she won't mind me saying this, but she, for a lot of things, she will read it aloud to herself towards the end of the process to make sure that it actually sounds right. Right. Like, was it Ezra Pound? And God, I'm going to get, maybe we'll get hate mail. That would be a first, quoting Ezra Pound. But like his whole thing is that you should never write something that couldn't conceivably come out of someone's mouth.
Right.
And I think that's a good rubric to use. It's like, if you read something and it's not, I mean, look, there are exceptions to be made for a lot of this, very experimental stuff, but if it doesn't ring true, then it's wrong. Like that's a bad translation. That's all there is to it. And being able to spot those things and understand that there's a fault somewhere in the translation versus a fault in the original is a way to sort of judge the quality of a translation. Wouldn't you say?
Yeah, and it does come with some sort of practice and like not even like you don't even have to get it confirmed usually. Like you can, I mean, we do when we're working with translators and like this, something's wrong here, and they'll be like, go back to it and be like, no, you're right. There was something wrong. I had misread the sentence or, you know, had one word wrong. And like, that just changed the whole meaning of it. But you start to pick up on that and can tell like when it is the author versus the translator to a degree. But, but sometimes it's just like, well, the book's not working. So like as a publisher, then you have that question, the eternal question of like, how much do you sort of adjust it to make sure that the book works in the language that you're publishing it in? If you're investing all this money, you don't want to invest it in a book that you're like, this doesn't work very well. We had a book, I don't remember if we talked about it in here, but there's a book that we added a couple paragraphs to that we wrote because otherwise it just didn't function like at all.
Right. There's a lot of, I mean, you do this a lot as a publisher, as you sort of assess, because if you're publishing translations, you're publishing things that come from another context entirely. Mm-hmm. And if the book itself relies on knowledge of that context, and look, everything is sort of relative, but if it tips the scale too far and like your average reader is not going to understand the context and get what's being done, then it's unfortunately just hard. It's going to be a very hard book to convey to an American reader. Yeah. And that's unfortunate because I'm sure there are a lot of good books that are wholly dependent on their native context, but that's just the way it goes. You know, you can't be adding, like you're talking about, can't be adding tons of footnotes. You can't add paragraphs every few pages in order to clarify things.
Yeah.
If it's relying like a cultural sort of knowledge, right?
Right.
So there's that sort of thing. Like, is the book working? Is it failing in its, you know, new language?
One of the more interesting situations for this, to sort of move to like a more specific part of it is assuming this all works out, we're getting the rights to these two books by this Indian writer who is like, I don't want to say too much because I don't want anyone to screw us on this, but we already have like the offer in and everything seems to be cool with it. But the author is like an Indian author who is inspired a lot by William Burroughs and uses cut up techniques and various other things. All very, very interesting. The books are interesting, but they're also like incredibly wedded to an Indian context, which is very hard to understand for an American readers because we don't understand necessarily the caste systems, even the politics, all the like sort of terminologies. It's a very complicated situation. And Jason Grunbaum wrote this really good essay for, I believe it's On Translation, the book that Columbia brought out, in which he talks about translating from Hindi into English and that there's two different Englishes you can choose. You can choose to translate it into the English that's used in India, where most people do read in English and where the book would have like a very wide audience and have a lot of sales. Or you could translate it into an American English in which you're explaining things that you would never explain to an Indian reader, but the Indian readers won't like the American English because it's really dumbed down, but the American reader might just not be able to fathom the Indian version of the English. And it seems like it's one of those that's really complicated because of the way that that English has been adapted and evolved in India. And with this book, these two books that we're going to do, it comes up a lot. And I'm not sure how we're going to resolve it at this point in time, but it's like an interesting editorial and publishing challenge of like, this is cool, this is interesting. How far do we have to domesticate this? Because without it, we're just like, without doing anything, it would be something that would be a curiosity more than something that would be enjoyed.
Wow. Yeah, that's tricky. Like, I'm sure, I mean, we've talked, maybe not on the podcast, but, you know, how many words you choose to leave in the original language when it is something for Americans where they would have some familiarity with it, right?
Yeah.
Like, just how many French terms are people familiar with? And how many Spanish terms are people familiar with? Because they've seeped into our culture through other books or through movies or just, you know, the culture in general.
Yeah.
Is very tricky, you know, and you don't want to alienate people who don't know what those terms mean. But at the same time, sometimes those terms are just so perfect in the original language. And if people even have like, you know, a 60% comprehension of what it means in the context, maybe it's better to leave it in the original, you know,
and yeah.
It's tricky without it being distracting, right?
Right.
With fusing. Which is what you sounds like you're being forced to deal with.
Yeah, yeah. So I'd be curious to see how we do it. We have no good solution right now, and since we haven't signed the contracts, we haven't really gone that far down it. But it's cool. It's a cool problem to have in comparison to other ones. I think.
You know, interesting. The things I've translated, you know, and helped Emma out with, they're often like the truly complicated. Like, how do you get this across to an American reader who doesn't understand that in the French, there was a pun, right? Yeah. Like, that is very difficult to fix. It, like, for example, this one that we have coming out with Restless next year, there's a, and I'm going to get the name wrong because it's not in front of me, but there's a train station in Paris, like one of the last stops, and I forget which train, mm-hmm. You know, back from World War I era, where it, unfortunately, you know, for us, unfortunately, shares it. The name is so close to World War I era derogatory term for German soldiers was Bosch, I think, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right? And so the name of this train station was something like Beauchelieu l'Enfer, right? And so the soldiers at this camp took that and changed it to Beauchelieu, like Bosch place hyphen l'enfer, hell. Bosch hell, basically.
Okay.
And I was like, that's the pun that's going on here? Fuck, do I put that in English, right? And so in the end, I was just like, I told the editor, I was like, this is what this means. If I don't explain this, it's going to be lost on every American reader. But putting a footnote in seems kind of obnoxious. So in the end, we were just like, fuck it. We're just leaving the name and that's that. If people want to look it up and try to piece it together, like, they can do it, but it's going to be tricky. But
yeah.
Like, how do you, managing those little things is, to me, very fascinating. Like, yeah. I love trying to piece all that together, trying to figure out like when you translate something that's old, right? Like the turns of phrase are not the same. And all of those sort of little, like the individual words might make sense, right? But then you have like, it meant something at the time. It was used as a metaphor for X, right? But like historically, doing the research into that and figuring that out is endlessly fascinating. I love doing that kind of stuff.
There's a really cool, so Bill Johnson has this new translation that came out called, it's like a famous poem from Poland. It's like their kind of national epic poem. It seems very funny too. I saw him give a talk about it. It's both like historic and entertaining. But he went through and he was trying to figure out like which words he shouldn't be using because they would be so much more modern than what existed back at the time that this book was written or this poem was written. And he gave this presentation at Breadloaf about it. And I don't have this handout anymore, but he played a little game with like, here are 12 terms. Like, which do you think are before this period, whatever it was, like 1830, and which ones were after? And there's like a lot of them that were like surprising. We'd be like, there's no way that this word could possibly have existed at that point, but it did, and in a somewhat different context or like a somewhat different meaning. But that it was kind of cool to see like how much work he had gone into of like, can I use this term or should I just avoid it?
Right.
But it's sort of along those lines.
Yeah. I mean, that's what it is. It comes down to, I mean, we were talking about before, like make a decision. You have to be confident. You have to know what you're doing.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it's funny. So I was on the, you know, I was in Switzerland last week for the jury. I was on the jury for this Jan Michalski Foundation, which has writer's residencies, and they have a lot of translators and who apply for residencies there. And, you know, we're sitting around the table, and so you can only apply in English or French, right? And so everyone's sort of assessing. So you have a lot of people who are translating from X language into French and X language into English. And so we're reading these, and we're at a certain point, you look at it and you think, okay, the original text that this person wants to translate is fascinating. The translation is a little rusty, you know, it doesn't seem quite right, blah, blah, blah. The person is 24 years old, just out of college. They need a break, right? Like,
yeah.
We ended up taking a couple where it's like, look, and there are no workshops there, but at the same time, like, these people need time to do their work. You can't just, like, everyone needs their first translation. Everyone needs their first assignment. Everyone needs their first space to work with an editor with a goal in mind as opposed to a classroom setting. And it, look, a lot of them are going to be not the greatest things in the world, just like a lot of first novels are not often very great, but you can see the greatness in them, right? So it's tricky. It's really tricky to sort of assess things and say, maybe we should allow this translator to do this because I think they'll be really good on the next project. And we might have to do all the heavy lifting on this first one, but let's do it anyway. And a lot of times, you know, look, it might not pan out.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. It's kind of like what it's also very similar to like the workshop that we do, like even going back to, we read all the people's stuff out loud. And that's when the first time that they're like hearing their own translations read out loud and what sounds awkward or doesn't sound awkward and why, how people react to it. So they get to see people who are published translators or editors or publishers or writers reacting to like the words that they put down there. And it makes a huge difference. Like, not to diminish any of the other schoolwork that they do or other people they work with, but I think that going through that workshop, even just sitting in on it and seeing how you react to other people's translations is the most beneficial thing for the students in the program here over the course of their time in the program by far. Cause it gives them like a much better sense of like how things sound and how to do it, how to react to that.
Right.
But
it's, yeah.
On a sort of separate note, I remember the other thing that we forgot that we were going to talk about. Did you see what the Great American Novel is? Great American Read, Great American whatever the fuck it is.
Yeah. It's, To Kill a Mockingbird?
Yes, To Kill a Mockingbird.
I mean, look, at least it's not an actual kid's book.
It's just the last book that most people who voted had ever read.
Yes, that is absolutely true. But at least, like, it wasn't Harry Potter, and
yeah,
that would not be good.
I thought for sure it was going to be Harry Potter. So.
Oh yeah, me too.
That's a positive. But what was the other thing that we were going to talk about?
Oh, this.
Oh yes. Rant
thing?
Oh my God! So I found out about this from Will Evans sent it to me, but there's Creative Europe is some sort of whatever. So it's some sort of like a culture program. So Creative Europe helps fund things for culture. And there's an article from their news files that says That's from October 14th of this year. Five UK-based publishing organizations are being awarded €245,000 to produce, promote, and translate slates of literary works from one European language to another. In the results of 2018's Literary Translation Call, a strand in Creative Europe's culture sub-program, publishing houses from England and Wales are among those selected for either slate or framework partnership agreement funding. I don't know what any of that means. Here's the important part. The following four England-based organizations have been chosen for slate support for 3 to 10 fiction works over 2 years that they're going to do. So they're going to do 3 to 10 translations over the course of 2 years. Bristol-based children's publisher Book Island is getting £18,000. Arenda Books is getting €58,000. And then Quirkus is receiving €97,649. And Random House is getting €45,695 to translate 3 to 10 books over 2 years, which seems like an insane thing. Like, Random House and Quirkus don't need this money.
No, absolutely not. Do they not need that money? And it's obscene that they would give these like for-profit publishers that money.
That's much money. It's crazy. I don't know what Parthian Books is. They're based in Wales, and they're getting $25,000 to do like one a book called Voices from the Margins, Keeping Wales and Europe Through Translation. And they're doing more. They're doing 3 to 10 fiction works for up to 3 years. But I don't just that's so I don't like this. I like that. I mean, it's the amount of money is equivalent to, like, I guess the Quirkus one's way outsized, but the other ones are sort of equivalent to what the NEA gives to nonprofit publishers. But those are nonprofit publishers who are only can only continue to do their work if they receive money from the NEA and other sources. Quirkus and Random House do not. They don't need... I don't like this. Makes me sad.
It's very frustrating that either one of those... It's not even like... Look, there are small for-profit publishers that maybe... Like New Directions is for-profit. Like, they could use some help paying translators, right?
Yeah.
Fucking Random House?
I mean,
it's just obscene to give them money... It's basically just a way – they're just funding a corporation. Corporations don't need money. Oh, God, it's very frustrating.
No, they definitely don't. Although this Parthian Books, what's interesting is they have their – the only picture on this article is of Parthian Books, and it's all of their Baltic series. It's four books that they did. I know this person is Estonian. This person I'm 90% sure is Latvian. That person's Lithuanian. But they all look kind of nice. They look like nice, interesting books. I haven't heard of these people. Maybe I should have. But they good for them. But, like, fuck Random House getting that much money. And Quirkus, almost €100,000? Oof.
That's crazy.
That is super crazy.
Unless people don't know this, everyone knows about Random House and everything that they've published. Quirkus, at least in the UK, has published, am I wrong here, Stieg Larsson?
Yep. They were the ones who found Stieg Larsson.
They have so much money. So much money.
Yep. Yeah, they tried to take a book from us once because they did the follow-up to Maidenhair by Mikhail Shishkin. And they're like, well, mm-hmm. we want the US and UK rights to Maidenhair. And I was like, no, I'm not going to do that. And they're like, well, you should give him to us because we're a much bigger press than you are and we can do a lot more for him. So we should just be able to publish his book. And I was like, fuck you. They never even made an offer. They just were like, we just deserve this book. Because we're big. So I'm a little resentful towards them. Which doesn't help. But yeah, they are the Stieg Larsson. They've got lots of money for that.
Lots and lots and lots of money.
And I mean, they do other authors that also sell well. So it's not only that, but like, oof. Ugh, I don't know. Anything else going on that you wanted to hit upon? I was going to tell you guys, I figured out the books I'm going to use in my spring class. And I figured out a way to use books from all different languages, no repeat languages, and no repeat publishers, which I feel very proud of. Because I always do the class in the spring, which I've talked about a billion times, is the one where they all read, everyone reads the book, and then they talk to the translator, and at the end of the class, they have to choose one of these to win an imaginary award. So I'm planning on using Codex 1962 by Schoen, Pretty Things by Virginie Despont, Mina by Kim Sagwa, Bride and Groom by Elisa Ganeva, Ma Bole's Second Life by Xiao Hong, Twist by Harkatz Kano, Tea Singer by Dag Solstad, Kumamadre by, I think it's Roque Lerque, Printed in Beirut by Jabour Duhali, River by Esther Kinski, and Checkpoint by David Al-Bahari, which is all different publishers, all different languages. I feel like I win at that. So I usually post this online because some people always buy these books because they're like, for whatever reason, they think it seems like a good reading list. So I will post that so that people can get all those without having to re-listen to my mispronunciations a bunch of times. But it should be a fun class because it's a loaded number of interesting books and a lot of good translators that are involved in here.
Cool. What else? Oh, I after reading through 130 of those applications, jury, I finally had time to start reading again. So,
whoa.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I'm reading Paradise Rot. Have you come across this yet?
No, I don't think so.
It's by Jenny Haval.
I like her music a lot. I did this to sound familiar, but that's why, because I know of her as a musician.
It's published by Verso, who does not do a lot of literature. So might be another reason why it hasn't come across your radar.
I saw this. I just forgot the title of it.
Comes with a blurb from Chris Krause. I mean, it's published by Verso. This is like everything I want from a book, basically. And it's interesting. I thought it was going to be more like Chris Krause in terms of style, but it's not at all. It's actually pretty straightforward sort of writing style with like a lot of like punctuated sort of observational sort of lens that it puts its plot through. But it's really good. She's definitely a very, very, very like, she's somebody who's like a very keen observer of social interactions and like different settings and all those sorts of things. And it's very, I'm really liking it. I think for a certain type of reader, i.e. people who shop in our bookstore, it's perfect. But
that's cool. I'll try and pick that up during one of my 19,000 visits. To all the bookstores on my next trip. There's an image on the Verso, the playlist from Jenny Ball that's on the Verso website, has a very disturbing image.
The one with the
blood
between her eyes there? Yeah, I don't quite know what that is.
Don't like it. Stay away from that. I haven't listened to her new EP yet either, but it's on, actually I have listened to one of the songs on it because it came up on my weekly list, but she's great. She's cool.
Maybe I'll have to listen to some today.
I don't know if it's your sort of thing or not, but
you really know what kind of thing is.
it's any number of things.
I suppose.
I just finished. I'm almost done. When I finished Revenge of the Translator, I'll have read all of the new Deep Vellum books on my little quest to finish, read all of them all at once, including like the Oulipian members, the Pablo Martin Sanchez book, The Anarchist, who had my same name, I think it's called, and Eduardo Berti is The Imagined Land. The Eduardo Berti book is pretty good. They're both really good. I think the Eduardo Berti one's a little bit more interesting because it's a little tighter. But but it's been interesting to read five books from one press, or four and 30 pages, because I gave up on one of them after 30 pages. I just did not get it and did not like it.
Which you're not going to tell me, are you?
No, I wrote about it. I wrote a whole article about it. It's called, I'm just going to try and find what the title is. It's like Memories of Desire? No, that's wrong. What is it? It is... It's by a Portuguese writer, and it is called... God, how do you find shit on our website? Okay, we need to fix our website if I can't find what I'm looking for on here. It's called The Geography of Rebels Trilogy, and it's by Maria Gabriela Llansol, and I couldn't get into it in the least. And it's like experimental in the way that I would think that I would like. And I wrote the very, very, very long post about this and related it to like my struggle, in particular, as to like how, not only how is it hard to get into this, and I feel bad that like it's a book that should appeal to me and I don't like it, but then also like the influence of if someone were to review this really widely and someone that I really respect, I'd probably change my mind and be like, no, this book is great, like, and the insecurities surrounding that. But then also like her disinterest in appealing to a reader or being interested in who's reading this versus like the incessant way in which Knausgård, for all of his like faults of being boring and being long and whatever, is 100% obsessed with the fact that the reader is there at every moment in time. And they do these things completely differently. But the book is wild. I can't even tell you what it's about, because it's just a bunch of like random sort of imagery, more like a poem than anything else, and doesn't really add up to anything in my mind.
Did you like the anarchist who had my name?
Yeah, I did. It's really long, but it reads pretty quickly. For given that it's almost 600 pages long, and there's some parts that you could have trimmed out, so it could have been like a 450 page book, and that would have been great. It doesn't. Neither that nor the Bruti have any Oulipian constraints or constructs to them. They're both members of the Lipo, so you know, I guess that counts then as Oulipian books just through that premise. But they're not using any specific structures. And the anarchist one has like a sort of twist at the end where it comes in on itself. And leaves like a certain idea open. I'm not going to spoil for anyone who is reading it, because it is a very plot-based sort of novel, and that's pretty okay. And the way that it ends up telling its story, where it intersperses chapters of the present moment and then the past to tell this anarchist life. It ends up where when you read the past ones, the last section of the past ones is the first chapter of the present. Like the same paragraphs are repeated, and it sort of circles in on itself. And that's pretty cool. But like, yeah, overall it's pretty interesting, because like anarchy is always fun. Anarchists are always fun to read about, and like rebelling against Spain and that period of time, like after World War I, is pretty interesting. But it's kind of just a fun book to read. And it is very like conventional in sort of its plot and like the way that it's telling the story. I did like. I like the Imagined Land a little bit better, I think, because it was a little bit tighter and a little bit more mysterious at times. And it's mostly like sort of like almost love story between these two girls. But it's got a lot to it. And it's weird, though, because I brought this up when I wrote about this one, of where it's an Argentine dude who lives in Paris writing about a 14-year-old Chinese girl in like the 1910s, I believe, and or 20s. And so there's like some things where like it has a lot of stuff about like Chinese rituals or beliefs or like things that they do, like they take their birds out to like this pond so that they can continue to sing, so that their household will stay healthy, all these sort of like superstitions. And I was a little bit weirded out by that, because I could see someone making a criticism that like this guy shouldn't be writing about that, and it's creating these stereotypes of China that are probably not true. And that's a little bit weird, but overall the book is really well written and very cool, and I think it's worth reading.
Cool.
Yep, that's all I've got right now. On the plane, after I finish The Revenge of the Translator, I'm going to read Shelley Jackson's new book. Do you like her?
I don't even know what that is.
It's called Riddance. She wrote Half-Life some time ago. It's been a number of years since she had a novel come out. But the full title is Riddance, or The Sibyl Joins Vocational School for Ghost Speakers and Hearing Mouth Children.
Hmm. Yeah, I never read Half-Life.
I liked Half-Life quite a bit. Like, the ending sort of wrapped it up a little bit, if I remember right, I like the first two-thirds of it better than the last third, but I did like it. She's going to be here in Buffalo the weekend that I get back, so I'm going to go see her, and so I want to read it before I go to see her. They have a nice little, Catapult has a pretty little cover design on their website for this. I'll link to this, but it's a motion thing where it sort of draws the cover.
Interesting.
Anyways, I don't have anything else. I should probably go teach my class and then get on a plane.
All right.
I will talk to you soon, and we'll be back in a couple weeks with more. You can always email us. You can follow us. You can do everything you want to do. So everyone knows how to do that, I assume. Absolutely. By this point in time. Okay, cool. I'll talk to you soon, man.
All right. Thank you. Bye. Bye. Statistics and news.